My name is Anita Flohr. I'm a postgraduate student at the Center for Tropical Marine Ecology in Bremen. And as part of Genus, I'm working towards my doctorate, looking at the nutrient cycle, but predominantly the carbon cycle here in the Benguela Upwelling system. My main tasks during an exhibition like this include taking numerous water samples. I take these water samples from the bottom water sampler and the CTD rosette. The bottom water sampler is used to sample the 1.5 meters of the water column above the sediment. And in contrast, the CTD rosette is designed to scan and sample the entire water column. The CTD rosette is a very important device for the research I want to carry out. CTD stands for conductivity, temperature, depth. And the CTD will now be lowered through the entire depth of the water down to just above the seabed, and effectively records an online profile of the oxygen content, the temperature and the salinity. This site here is around 360 meters deep, but we could work at a depth of up to 5,000 meters with a CTD rosette. So on this monitor, we can effectively follow online as the depth profile of the individual parameters is displayed. Each site shows a completely different profile, and depending on these profiles, I then decide what depth I want to sample. And now you can briefly tell me what depth you are sampling for me. Which ones would you like? I would like the 30 and the chlorophyll maximum. Now the CTD rosette is back on deck, the water samplers have closed, and now I have to double check that this is the correct sampler. Number 12. I have also prepared various sample bottles for the different parameters I want to measure. These ones here, for example, are exertainer tubes. I now have to fill these without any air bubbles, and then later the dissolved inorganic carbon will be determined. A good rinse.
And a check.
And check that it is free of air bubbles. This bottle here is filled with a sample to determine the alkalinity. This also has to be rinsed first. And along with the results of the dissolved inorganic carbon, we can then determine the carbonate system from these two parameters. Then we can state how much CO2 is dissolved in the water and how acidic the water is. I fill this bottle with water for the nutrient analysis and for determining the DOC. DOC stands for dissolved organic carbon. The water samples are now processed in different ways. The samples are sometimes only measured after 2 or 3 days or only after the expedition back in Bremen. In order to ensure that the samples are kept exactly as they were when I filled them, they have to be fixed. We can do this by poisoning or freezing the sample. This stops all the biological processes that could have an influence on the parameters I want to measure. The samples for determining the alkalinity and the analysis of dissolved inorganic carbon, for example, are poisoned and are measured here on board. The samples for the analysis of dissolved organic carbon are frozen and then measured back in Bremen. The nutrient samples are measured on board straight away, so fixing is not necessary. The only thing that has to be done first is to filter the water sample. By pushing the water through this filter here, all of the minute organisms that are larger than 0.45 micrometers in size are trapped in the filter, and this cleans the sample, which is then ready for analysis.
Und ist dann aber auch schon bereit zur Analyse.
When the nutrient samples have been analyzed, we can create profiles. What we can see here is an oxygen profile, a nitrogen profile, and a phosphate profile. And what is very characteristic of the Namibian shelf are these distinct oxygen minimum zones. These are shown here in red. This is an area in which the amount of dissolved oxygen in the water column is very low. This is in contrast to sites away from the coast, where we measure very high oxygen values. And what happens in these oxygen minimum zones on the shelf here is that nitrogen is lost from the water column through processes such as denitrification and anammox. This means that we measure moderate nitrogen concentrations above the shelf, but the maximum values are usually away from the coast and at greater depth. For phosphate, the situation is actually the other way around. Phosphate increases greatly in these oxygen minimum zones. And this is actually due to the activity of bacteria that live in oxygen-deficient conditions and add phosphate to the water column.
Und das Resultat ist eben, dass sich diese beiden Nährstoffe stark verändern.
The result is that the ratio of the two nutrients changes significantly, and this variant nutrient ratio is then brought to the surface during the upwelling and transported into the open ocean and to the South Atlantic, with repercussions for the nutrient balance in the South Atlantic.